Okay. Good afternoon. Welcome to the final class of the ethics course, which I know has been captivating all of you, probably keeping you awake at night, right? Yeah. How do you get up? You get up in the morning because you're thinking ethics with Achan Sarod and Achan Nick. And we're going to have an interesting panel for you today. I think you've read all about them, but I'll give you just a few quick words about our people. Please, what we're going to do is run through each of the panelists. They'll have a brief statement to make. They're all very specialized in their own field, and you'll see what those fields are as you listen to them. Come up with any questions you might have. Write them down. After all four have spoken, we'll have the Q&A period. Okay? So try to restrain yourselves. I know it's going to be difficult, but please do. Our first speaker will go from your left to right. Our first speaker will be Dr. Orapin Sopchokchai, who is now an independent consultant. She's been an Achan, and she's been in government, in and out of government, for many, many years. So she's got a CV that would fill three or four volumes at this point. But she'll be sharing the benefit of her experience with us today. Then we have, following Achan Orapin, we'll just run through them. We don't have to introduce them again. We'll have Colin Hastings, who is the publisher of Big Chili magazine. Have any of you seen Big Chili around? Huh? Okay, Big Chili up there. Okay, and he's in a bit of pain right now. We're trying to get him some pills to relieve that. We'll see if we can work on that. He's been in journalism for a long, long time, involved in some exploits that you probably don't want to hear about, but he'll be telling us today what we'd like to hear about. Then after Colin, we've got Kun Wichai Bencharongkun, who is here primarily as representing the Sasin Alumni Association, but he's got many, many other interests as well. As you can see, founding member of the Better Sasin Group. He's president, of course, of Benchanin Group, holding a group, and he's honorary president of the Telecommunications Association of Thailand. So he has been around the block a few times, many more times than he looks. He is older than he looks, believe me. Then we have, after Kudwichai, we have Pandit Bhikkhu, who is an English monk who's at Wat Pak Nam. He has interests, as you can see here, in many, many things. The one that appeals to me most is the fairy tales. So if you have any thoughts about fairy tales you'd like to share, I'm sure he'd like to hear them. So without further ado, if there are not any questions, we will proceed with Achan Orapin.
Well. Good afternoon, class. And in Thai, we must say Namaskar Pakun Chao. I don't know how to say it in English. Today, I think, is a very good day for you, and it's not a very good day for me. It's a good day for you because, what I'm going to share with you is the topic is very important. Since you're going to go out in the future, you will be a leader in business. And I have several things that to share. Okay, my topics today is business ethic and ethical leaders. How it go? Okay. In business school now, worldwide, not only here at Sasin, business ethic has become what we call hot and sexy topics. Many university now, set up what we call the institute, to create what we call ethical leaders. Because if you look, I think in the class you probably discussed about what happened in business around the world. Not long ago, there was a financial scandal, and many big company failed, and had been declared bankrupt, and a lot of people involved in that company. You heard about Enron, you heard about Price Waters, you heard about many organizations, If you look into the case study, you will see that, you know, there's a lot of people have to go to jail, and some people, you know, one in the case of Enron, one person had been murdered. The family suspected he was murdered, but you know, according to the police, he committed suicide or accident or whatever. Okay, that was the event. That was the incidents that activate the interest of the business ethic. Okay, after follow that, you know, the government has set up the many regulation. Okay, and then all this concept of corporate governance and business ethic had been important for many organizations. The business ethic or ethical leaders, some school, you know, business school will have a class on business ethic, but other school, at the university level, they set up what we call ethical leader. The leader is ethical leader is the they set up the institute, so all is required that all the university students have to go through that workshop or classes offered by this organization. Make you see that why this topic is so important. Okay, why is so important? Because you know this business is kind of sector that is very important for economics. Okay, you can lead through this. You know, it create a job. It's promote economic growth and stuff like that. Blah blah blah. And the business is part of the communities. It's not let alone or it's not living in the back box. In the back box. Okay. So it's the firm had to be responsible or respect. You know, the thing that happened in the country or in the communities or the so. Okay, the business at the same time they have to protect and encourage the employee, even the retiree. You know, who won't have the brand of that company or stuff like that, or even the shareholder. You know, the shareholder of the company. They want to encourage them to be to act ethical, and you know, the many company have policy on it. If you look through that, you know, many company now around the world have a very strict policy on ethical conduct. Okay, you heard about 3M, 3M company that produce a lot of glues and tapes and stuff like that. Okay. I have a friend who work in that company. They have a very, very strict rule on to enforce in the company that, you know, there no corruption, or they cannot pay bribe to anyone. If anyone, for example, that 3M Thailand, they try to sell something to one company or the hospital or whatever, because they sell a lot of medical supply, okay, and then they try to bribe the buyers or the officers. If someone, the policy was, you know, was like this. If they got caught, okay, all the news leak out that, you know, the part of us, one of the staff, the sales staff tried to bribe, the managers or, you know, Thailand managers will be fine. Also, know the regional managers have to be fine too. So that is really strict, you know. That was the thing that my friend told me. Also, the same thing that happened with the Shell, you know, the oil company, the Shell company. They had a similar rule of that one. So when you work in a company in a, now or in a big company, you have to be very careful about, you know, what you're going to do and what you think you're going to do. Okay, this is the thing that. Why, you know, business ethic is very important for you in the future if you want to work. Okay, this is the concept of what is the ethical, your ethics. Okay, in fact, it's a value system. You know, sometimes it cannot be very difficult because you cannot touch it. It's a thing that people know. The thing that is a set of standard that people set, like what I told you about the 3Ms and the Shell company and stuff like that. this value they have people who set the principle and you know the principle or the value that what is the right or the wrong thing. Okay. The very sensitive and the most difficult is sometimes when people think this the thing is right, all right, and another people can see that this is the wrong thing. So it's very difficult to measure. So you have to observe what happened in the fields. Okay. What is the moral principle for the or ethical standard that is the that guide the business behavior? Okay. In a general rules or the corporate governance, they will say that the all the business have to be fairness to all stakeholders. What does that mean? Fairness to all stakeholders mean that, you know, this is for the I think it's a pride for the big company, you know, the company that have a lot of shareholders. Or even the shareholder, you know, sometimes the company have one owners or several owners. You have to be fair to all the shareholders. And when we talk about stakeholders, what is the stakeholder of the business? There's a lot of stakeholders for the business. Okay, if you are customer, you are also stakeholders. If you're shareholder, you are stakeholders. Okay. The second thing is you have to be honest. Honesty is, you know, people said honesty is a good policy, but a lot of time, you know, you cannot find honest in many ways. Okay. We're talking about transparency in management. Okay, transparency in management is mean that, you know, in both internal and external, you need to be transparent. This is the thing that it introduced into good corporate governance. Okay. Leaders or people who do the business have to be accountable to all decision. Accountability is quite difficult, especially in Thai societies. You know, in Thai language, we don't have the words for accountability yet. Okay, we try to find a word, but it's just have to have a sentence to explain the word accountability. Accountability is a thing that you need to be accountable for whatever you have done or whatever you decide or the performance of each person in the company. Okay, and they have to be responsible to comply with the law, professional standard. What is professional standard? If you are accountants, okay, if you find something wrong, a professional standard say that you need to report it, you need to disclose that information, that what happened with the Emron, the accountants, you know, they follow the professional standard instead of follow the government, the company policy. That's why they disclose the information. Okay. This is the most difficult thing. Okay, the green area and the red area, it's easy. Okay, but the most difficult thing is the gray area. But the gray area is the green area is, you know, ethical action or behavior. You know, ethic. You know, they are good. They're doing things. They're good thing. They think they have a good outcome or, you know, the performance. Unethical. I have the unethical over both the gray area and the red area. Okay. The gray area is the thing that is not so harmful, but is unethical, you know, unethical behavior or performance. The gray area may not lead into criminal wrong or, you know, they may not break the law, but, you know, it will lead to many problems in the future. But the red area is if this is unethical. If people have done it, it will end up, you know, facing the lawsuit or you go to jail for that one. Okay. What is the thing that challenging the business? The thing that challenging the business is here. That's why the people who work in the modern world now, they have a big, what we call question mark, and then likely to go into what we call the gray area. Okay, the first one is the conflict of interest. A lot of people cannot separate between what is a conflict of interest or what is not a conflict of interest. Okay, it's a situation that you should in which the employees must choose between the business welfare and personal gain. Okay, a lot of time, conflict of interest. Even in my experience, a lot of people who had experienced, have a lot of experience, and it considered to be a good person in this, arena or whatever he had done. They can, a lot of things that have done, they could not understand what we call the conflict of interest. Okay. The second one is honesty and integrity. And that this is the second word that we don't have the word in Thai, integrity, no Thai words. So this is tell you something. If there is no translation of that Thai, integrity, it means that we don't have that behavior in these societies. That what Khun Anan Banyalachun told me. We've been try to find a word, Thai words for two, okay, accountability and integrity. There's no translation for that one. So most of the words, no vocabulary in Thai. We have translation, but no vocabulary, precise vocabulary to use for that one. Okay, so this is a thing that we need to really enforce in our Thai society. The third one is loyalty versus trust. Okay, a lot of time, people want to be loyal to act to the best interest of the company. Okay, the loyalty is mean that they need once they're loyal to the company, and then they probably overlook the one something that is not so ethical behaviors. Okay. The last one is whistleblowing. So this is a thing, whistleblowing is someone who disclose information, like in many companies, if they find something, they will disclose information to the media. Okay, I have several, I want to cross this because I run out of time, if you look at the damage, from unethical performance. Okay, I want to leave here, if you remember, a very big issue, I think at the end of last year, or I think early last year. Remember the microphone projects? Microphone projects. That was the thing that happened. For many people, the thought is, it's in the gray area. It's not unethical. What is a microphone project was, remember that it's not corrupt yet, but it's almost get into the corruption problem. Okay, one time the government, the office of prime minister want to improve what you call the cabinet meeting room. And they bought a microphone, not bought yet, they installed a microphone, and the leader or CEO of that office, bring the media and show off how good the microphone is. It's like a very fancy microphone, and the price was it's about 145,000 baht per microphone. And it's become quite amazing because, this is very fancy one. When you touch, it's a touch microphone. It's almost like the combine between the mobile phone and the microphone and the speaker at the same, in the same station. It looked very, very fancy. But the thing was, during this modern society, the social media and a lot of people can access information. It turned out that the price list of that microphone was only 99,000. Okay, so there was 46, 99,000 is only 46, is a 46,000 difference, baht difference, right? The question was, why is so expensive? Why is more expensive than the price list? So nobody can give the answer. So at the end, I think the company have to take back all the microphone that they already installed in the meeting room. The meeting room was almost complete. It's after it came out in the media, you know, it happened was there's no contract had been signed for that microphone project. Improvement, you know, like a meeting room, cabinet meeting room, it was an old cabinet meeting room. They want to use the like an option. There were no contract signed. Okay, so this is against the public procurement problem. So this is the, it showed that this is the unethical behavior from both government officers, the company, and also the what you call the company in that system. So at the end, what is the result? They terminate the projects. The government officer who involved in the system had been punished. The company lost the contract and also lost the reputation, lost the money because they had already installed and improved the room. And finally, I think the headquarter of that company in Germany, they want to investigate and perhaps terminate the contract. Okay, I think this is one of the example of unethical behavior and also in the gray area.
Thank you. I don't want to interrupt because I know you could go on all day with examples. Let's go on with our, thank you very much, Ajahn Orapin. Thank you, Ajahn, for a good talk, getting us some insights. And if we could move on to hear from Colin. Oh, by the way, did you get the pills or not?
Not yet, no.
We're working.
They're coming, they're on the way. Oh, thank you, Alex. That's nice of you. Good afternoon, everybody. Nice to be back here. I'll be wade straight into this. As a journalist and publisher, I'm constantly reminded of the need to act ethically at all times. Like all other media companies and organizations, my company, we follow a code of behavior that not only ensures that we're behaving responsibly and correctly, but also saves us from expensive and potentially ruinous lawsuits when we get it wrong. Actually, every media company has its own set of rules. The venerable New York Times, for example, issues all its journalists with a 48-page book on ethical journalism. It's a massive tome, rigorously covering everything from plagiarism and online harassment of rival journalists to gambling on sports by sports writers, of course, favoritism in the arts and politics, and why journalists should never accept gifts, however subtly they're packaged or disguised. Corruption actually takes up a large section of this New York Times book. I suspect that only two other professions, doctors and lawyers, have to confront more ethical considerations than journalists. Nonetheless, media companies, and I'm talking here about newspapers and magazines, as well as TV and radio, do get it wrong sometimes, despite their codes of conduct. And the fact is, those legal suits actually do fly around more often than they care to admit, though happily, most complaints are settled with a simple apology. These various ethical codes do have some differences, but basically they share many common elements. And they are basically these: truthfulness, accuracy, objectivity, impartiality, fairness, and public accountability. That's the ideal, of course. The truth is, journalism is far more complicated and complex. Many would say it was corrupt too. For example, newspapers in the West carry paid-for stories and such as PR releases and editorials written by politicians, senior government ministers, and even prime ministers. How impartial is that? In the months before, during, and even after Brexit, and I think you've probably all heard of Brexit, I hope so anyway, newspapers didn't hold back in telling their readers which side they backed. They often published or frequently published articles with considerable bias and allegedly plenty of lies and fabrications to support a particular cause. Again, where's the truthfulness and accuracy, etc., in that? There is none. Even the BBC, which is usually regarded as a bastion of impartiality, came under fire for what many thought was its biased coverage of Brexit. What happened to its code of ethics? And I'm sure many of you have watched the big American TV stations and thought to yourself, is their news coverage loaded? I'm sure you have. And how impartial is the coverage of recent wars when the majority of reporters merely repeat what the military tells them, or rather, what they want, that's the military, what the military want the media to know. Meanwhile, the Washington Press is always being criticized for excessive use of anonymous sources, in particular to report information that's later revealed to be unreliable. I move then onto the internet, and I think we all know how many stories and really fake, dodgy, and misleading stories are planted on the internet these days. It's a huge problem, and that's a massive issue to be discussed perhaps here some other time. But the internet is really playing its part in lowering ethical standards, in my opinion. Anyway, journalists and editors regularly face another kind of ethical, even moral dilemma. Under what circumstances, you might ask, are they justified in presenting depictions of violence, nudity, bad language? Should they allow photographs? Should they show photographs of people who've been hurt in a traffic accident, as has happened just recently in the UK? Or those maimed and killed in a terrorist attack or a full-scale war? Should they be allowed to do that, or should they be encouraged to do it? From an ethical point of view, it's a very, very tough question. On the one hand, images and graphic descriptions of war are often, of course, violent, bloody, shocking, and profoundly tragic. And they are extremely disturbing to some audiences. On the other hand, it's precisely these aspects of war that some consider to be the most important to convey. They argue that sanitizing the depiction of war influences public opinion about the merits of continuing to fight, and also about the policies or circumstances that precipitated the conflict. We've seen recently some pretty graphic photographs of these terrorist attacks in Europe. They've appeared in the media, though often they come with warnings about the nature of content. So there's an ethical thing there, but they're protecting themselves. The media's protecting itself. There's often considerable concern about obscuring or not reporting certain facts or details. They say it's self-censorship that compromises objectivity and ultimately the truth, which in the end doesn't serve the public interest. Reporters have also been accused of moral indecency in the process of collecting news. There's a famous story of a reporter, a European reporter, during the Congo crisis, who walked into a crowd of Belgian evacuees and shouted, "Anyone here been raped and speaks English?" That's terrible. I'll give some more cases later. The Society of Professional Journalists' advice on such, situations, it does actually focus mostly on the need to show compassion for those affected adversely by news coverage, especially children. It also rightly instructs reporters to be sensitive when seeking or using interviews or photographs of those affected by tragedy or grief. Show good taste, avoid pandering to lurid curiosity, it says. These are the sort of questions that the ethics advice line receives from journalists facing different ethical dilemmas. They ask questions like, is it ethical to make an appointment to interview an arsonist sought by police without informing the police in advance of the interview? Should a reporter write a story about a local priest who confessed to a sex crime if it will cost the newspaper readers and advertisers who are sympathetic to the priest? Is it ethical for a reporter to write a news piece on the same topic on which he or she has already written an opinion piece in the same paper. Anyway, these go on. There's lots and lots of these examples. Anyway, I'll just give you a couple of examples of other ethical dilemmas. Recently, Texas cops were caught on a video shooting an unarmed man who had his hands up in the air, surrendering. The sheriff's department claims that airing the footage on local TV was unethical. The sheriff's office said, and I quote, "Members of our local media chose to broadcast online unedited video of a man's death. A neighbor who filmed the tragedy was paid $100 by the TV channel for the exclusive rights to the video. As a result, people from outside our community have bombarded us with inappropriate comments and today physical threats towards our sheriffs. These cops have not been charged with a crime and a family has lost their loved one. This is unethical and sad." Unsurprisingly, some of the comments in response were highly critical of the police. And if you still don't think the media is corrupt, what about the former News of the World reporter who claimed that journalists at the now defunct British newspaper regularly made up stories? Unethical practices were rife, he said, because of a culture of fear at the tabloid. He says, "I've fabricated stories about drug dealers, neo-Nazis, people who were selling guns, people who were selling fake documents." There's also, it's pretty awful that reporters were discovered going through the wreckage of luggage of dead people in the crash site of Malaysian Airlines 17, which was shot down over Ukraine. They were looking for unique evidence that might bolster their stories. Then we've had the phone hacking scandal in Britain, which has involved celebrities whose private lives were revealed mostly on the internet. Just lastly, I guess, I worked for the Bangkok Post for 12 years. And though I didn't actually personally get involved, of course, in any corrupt practices, I am pretty damn sure that there was a fair amount of corruption in the Bangkok Post, which actually has probably got a cleaner record than most other newspapers in Thailand. Anyway, as you see, it's hard as it tries to be ethical, the reality is that the media is full of anomalies, contradictions, and surprises. And we should always look out for the unethical matters as much as we look at the ethical side. That's it. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you very much. Some food for thought there. We have some Americans in the audience, I think, right? So you'd be familiar with some of the news quandaries. The one that came out, I think it was yesterday, was actually in Florida. Are you familiar with this one in Florida? The gentleman was on the ground. He was actually trying to assist an autistic patient who had lost his way. He was sitting there helplessly on the ground, and this caretaker went up to him and tried to assist him. And the policeman came on the scene and said, halt, or I'll shoot. So the caretaker laid down on his back on the ground like this. On the ground, arms in the air like that, and the cops shot him. So that, and of course that was recorded and widely reported, and I'm sure the policemen were unhappy because what they came out with after a while was, it's not as bad as it looks. He was actually trying to shoot the autistic man who was sitting there by him and missed him and hit the other gentleman. So yeah, there are opportunities for ethical or abandoning ethical coverage are all over us, all around us. Thank you very much again, Colin. And can we chai cup?
Cup. Sawadee cup. Sawadee cup. I think we all here have a different understanding and a different, I think, set of understanding about ethical. I think it has to do with a lot with the culture. Also, part of it perhaps come from our religions. You know, the way we've been taught from different angle from our religion. But what is kind of the ethics? or ethical we are talking about today. Is it a set of moral standard that being set, or is it a set of value belief that each one of us who've been taught, brought up in a different family, different atmosphere, different environment, in different country, and have a set of value that we believe this is ethical and this is not? Or it's a set of kind of the social rules. You know, when you're in Sasin, you have certain belief, a certain code of conduct or certain ethical way to behave. So in Thai, you know, the word ethics, trying to find it in with Ajahn Gu or the Google, it said jariyatam, right? Or janyaban. What is this? You know, jariyatam, janyaban. I don't think we you know, many of us in Thai, we didn't really have that word carefully or thoughtfully taught in school. So we kind of brought up with what we heard from the older people, what we heard from monk when we go to the temple, or we go to the church and the priest kind of teach us. So it is really a big kind of meanings, you know. Like I said, it's brought down to that ethical behavior is basically trying to do or act in good faith, act of goodness in ourselves. So when we talk about business ethic, it is a lot of, you know, words around there, a lot of practice that we need to do, a lot of belief that we have to follow, or maybe is sometimes is dictated by the company or the society. You know, when we are in the company, when you say, well, this company have a business ethic, it come down with a list of things that they require you to do. First, when you interview, they ask you about some of this in your interview to check your sort of like your thinking, your mental thinking. Secondly, once they employ you, they make you sign a code of conduct, a Bible, that you will follow. Whether or not you read to them, or the 48 page or 100 page, you read or not, if you don't sign, you don't get your job, right? So I think most of the applicant usually kind of flip through and say, okay, let's sign. And then it's not my problem to follow through the code of conduct. Bible is more or less the HR people who have to be like a police and trying to track me down or maybe catch me when I'm kind of off the book. So it is really difficult to determine or trying to enforce this so-called ethic code of conduct in the company if you really don't believe it yourself. You know, the book you sign or the manual you sign is not gonna change you. Okay, I don't know, is anybody in this class believe that corruption is ethic, or corruption is okay, so-called?
And if you don't pay the assigned fee, then you won't get the job done. However, in my opinion, that practice is unethical to request the assigned fee.
Yeah. I know. It's no right or wrong. Basically, it depends on the angle you look at it. You know, first of all, maybe if you don't believe it, you sign it. Is it some kind of morally corrupt? You know, you sign something you don't believe, or the company forces you to sign something that they don't even tell you. So both sides have the problem. But anyway, I'm not here to judge who's right, who's wrong. I'm just kind of like, we are living in a very confusing world and a very complicated world, because it's really a very different standard of ethical or ethics belief on the planet here. I don't know about other planet, but in this planet, depends. Like I said, the culture, religions. So it is sort of like we have to find a mid path where we believe this is commonly shared with a lot of people. You know, I took the example of corruption because this is something that people do, it's a very dirty word. And this is the word that I think every time as a Thai, we go through morning paper, we go through evening news, this is the headlines, you know, apart from people shooting each other, okay? This is the headline that these people are corrupt. Our government, local government, big government, prime minister, blah, 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 corrupt. And this is really, as a Thai, this is a face of a Thai people that being exposed to the world. We are number 76, okay? A score 38 out of 100, which is a D plus, a C double minus or something like that. And this is show on the Thai face. If you come from Thailand, so you come from country where everything can be bought. Yeah, easy go, easy, sabai sabai, you know, if you want something, you, even, you know, as an expat living in Thailand, and we have a few friends, expat, they say, well, police, no problem. Just pay them, everything solved. And that's bad, you know. And I don't think we should be proud of that, you know, the number 76, which, okay, they said, oh, we are better because we used to be in number 85. Now we are better. But look at the score. The same score, meaning the world, the whole world getting worse. Everyone is just believe that corruption is good or acceptable, you know. In Sasin, we always love to use this word. It depends. When you have to kind of like try to explain that you have different opinions, it depends. It depends how you look at it. But this is what I'm trying to say, that ethics in business, or the business ethics, is very focusing on corruption in your workplace, corruption in the way you practice business, as Ajahn Orapin point out some example. We see this every day, and we see, sabai, sabai, chiu, chiu. It's okay, you know. If they're so corrupt, next time we have another coup, and take the corrupt, you know, the bad guy into somewhere, you know, or freeze them in a refrigerator, and wait till the somebody who's ruling the country then getting comfort, and then start corrupting again, because it's okay to taking small gift to the big gift later, you know, from small amount, from the favor to now, it's just how can I return the favor in big times, you know, a big load of cash in the pocket. So this is, I think this is going on and on and on. And, you know, as I was introduced, that we start up this the program called Better Sasin here. You know, me and my class colleague, Kun Atinut here also, she is in this class present. She is also the vice president of the Alumni Association. We work together. We were sitting in the same classroom here. We were talking, discuss, similar to your class here, in particular with Ajahn Nick here, about, you know, why we are circling in the same problem. And, you know, I'm older than her. I see this problem. She see this problem. The young generation see the same problem. Why can't we fix it? You know, and Thailand has been talking about this problem for a long, long time. And I think we are a small group of people here in Sasin. So we think perhaps, you know, every effort counts. So we are trying to promote the concept of, you know, business ethic, integrity, honesty, and trying to do better for society, starting from your small circle of society here, you know, even in Sasin. And perhaps as time goes by, after people, more people are buying in, more people are looking at you, and they listen to you, and they see you practice it, and perhaps they will start to realize and perhaps adopt it together with you, you know, because this is something I think it's easy to complain every day, but it's very difficult to act or to do it. You know, this is how people always say, oh, it's easy to complain, but, you know, to start doing something is very difficult because, oh, it takes a lot of effort. How can we change Thailand? How can we, you know, kill all the politicians? And politicians born every day. They've been groomed to be politicians every day. And once they sit in that chair, they act the same, no matter. They were so good, but sat there, they said, I'm not corrupt, but I allow my subordinate, I allow my party member to corrupt, I don't corrupt, so I'm clean. So is he okay or not? So that person also cannot call himself ethical politician because he allowed corruption to happen, you know, not behind his back, in front of his eye, but he just keep quiet, and, you know, and make himself look good. That's not good enough for us, right? So at Beta Sasin, this is what we, right? It's better to do it yourself than hope other people to do it, or wait until other people start doing it, and then you will do it. So you have to do it yourself. Right? So this is a kind of small initiative from our group that we want to promote this morals commitment. It's not mandatory. It's a voluntary basis. It's either you believe it, you want to do it, you want to follow it, you want to keep it. It's up to you. But at least we are starting this project, and we are starting to do it the right thing at one point in time. So, you know, this is, you know, just how we form it by E12, and, you know, a whole bunch of us are sitting, and we are pushing this project in school through the Alumni Association. And so what we are doing is a bit different from what Sasin asked you to sign. You know, we're not talking about right or wrong, but, you know, the code of conduct that Sasin need you to sign before you starting your school. But this is more like a personal oath that you committed yourself. No one else. You committed to yourself, you know, to promote the good value of yourself. And the benefit will not belong to anyone except yourself. Because this is something, if you truly believe in doing good things, doing morally things, then you keep doing it. You can stop whenever you want. So I think the goal that, yeah, of course, we want everyone to be trying to do something different. Of course, we want to set a higher standard for all of us individually, all of us. And also, we want to promote this so hopefully from 1 mouse to many more mouths, society will start recognizing that people from Sasin, they are different. We hope. And we are setting another level of standard for people who been through this in Sasin together. So, you know, I can answer more questions later, but please allow me to end for now. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very, very much. Some of you will know that the other institutions internationally have similar oaths. Thunderbird School in the United States, International Management School, was one of the first to popularize the idea. And the point, of course, is we as business people should feel every bit as proud and every bit as professional as anybody else. And if we do, why not stand up and say it? And so it makes a lot of sense to many of us. Thank you again very much. And now we'll hear from Pa Pandit.
Okay, thank you. So I'm the last one this afternoon. We're coming to the end of the day. So turn off your Facebook and your line and other things that you are playing with on the computers. I'm here each year as the supposed ethics expert. So if you're going to talk about ethics, it seems good to invite a monk along. And that might not be as obvious as it seems when you look at the Thai Sangha these days, whether we really are standing up for ethics. But there is a very good reason for that. As Dr. Aurapin was saying, that right now the topic of business ethics is very hot and sexy. So I'm very glad that my contribution to this world is becoming something hot and sexy. It's not a way that I usually think about myself. Talking about journalism, my friend who was a monk in England, his father wrote a very popular TV series. And the journalists went around to interview him about writing the TV series. And they saw on his mantelpiece that his son had ordained as a monk. And so they phoned up the monastery and they said to the son, can we come along and interview you as part of the article we are writing on your father? And the monk said, no. And that was the end of it for a few months. Then a few months later, in the center page of The Sun, do you know The Sun? Not the nicest of newspapers, but quite good fun, I guess. Sent full page, center spread. There was no article about this man who wrote the TV series. Full page, center spread, massive letters, sex and the saffron robe. And he had just made up the entire story. The only word he got from my friend was, no, I'm not going to interview you. And the entire story was how this supposed son of a millionaire had given up the family fortune in order to live without sex. And that was the entire story, full page, middle. So, I'm sure that some of you have seen the monks out on arms round in the morning. Have you got back late enough at night to see us out walking around for alms? Some of the houses that we go to, I have to say, are somewhat dangerous, and they have dangerous dogs, and more than once I've had a nip on the back of my legs. Fortunately, the more senior you get as a monk, it's the more junior people that walk at the end of the line. So the older you get, the less likely you are to be bitten. But it happens quite a lot, obviously, coming around people's houses, going into strangers' houses very early in the morning, the sun is just coming up. This kind of thing is going to happen. The interesting thing that I found was all the houses where the people put food into the alms bowl, in those houses, the dogs never bite. It's always the houses where the people never come out and put food into the alms bowl where the dogs will bite. So that's quite interesting, because the topic of, you know, we can talk about the ethics side, but the topic of leadership is really a question about influence. So I'm interested in the influence of the leaders of the household who put the food in the bowls of the monks in the morning, how their influence spreads even to their dogs. So, when I have been around in businesses around in Thailand, I find this same kind of thing happening. The influence of the people at the top spreading through the business. There is one bus line in Bangkok, and they are rather antagonistic towards us monks. Possibly because we don't pay any fare when we get on the bus. Right, that's one of the perks. There's lots of downsides to becoming a monk, which I would be very glad to tell you about, but the plus side is we don't have to pay 8 baht when we get on the bus. And when we're getting on this particular bus line, the bus always kind of moves like this, so we have to kind of run after it and jump on. If nobody is getting off the bus at the bus stop, then they refuse to stop for monks, right? And one time they were doing the road, making a underpass under the road, and it meant the bus went round a very long circular route and doubled back on itself. And this bus went past me and refused to pick me up. And so I went tearing off down the street, hopped over the canal, and I got the same bus as it came around further along the route. And I stood in the middle of the road like this and made sure that he stopped. And I went up and I wagged my finger in his face, which you shouldn't do in Thailand, but I did anyway. And the bus driver was quite amused. He was like, "Oh my God, I can't believe you actually came." You actually came round. And I said, "Why didn't you stop for me?" And he said, "I didn't see you." And I said, "I'm 6 foot tall, I'm white, and I'm dressed in orange. How are you not going to see me?" He found this quite amusing, as did the bus conductor. Another one of the bus routes is the orange bus, the aircon bus. Also I get for free, but they always stop, and they always... when I get on the bus, they always tell the passengers on the bus, you know, make way for the monk so he can sit at the front. And it's very different. It so happens that the owner of that bus line also is somebody who likes to do the alms round. They put food in the bowl, they invite monks to the bus depot. And this has a knock-on effect on the bus drivers. So the question of leadership is really a question of influence. What is your influence that you are having? When leadership was first studied, it started out as traits. What are the traits, psychological traits, that you need to become a leader or to be a good leader? And there were some problems with the trait theory. So the next movement in leadership theory was the question of power. How do you have power over other people? This was a lot more interesting to people. And there are different kinds of power that you can have over people. Later on, we got into more of a group dynamic and a transactional process. So it's not just the quality of the leader and them influencing the people, but more of a group dynamic. Some leaders are only good leaders in a certain situation, situational leadership. So it becomes much more of a group dynamic and less a dynamic of a teacher, of a leader influencing a particular group. As the final movement from that kind of theory, we had the idea of the group, which was split into leaders and followers. But the more later research in psychology is, how do the followers influence the leaders? And one of the films that I like to show, sometimes I teach this class on leadership, and one of the films I show is Marjo. I don't know if you've seen that. This was a Christian preacher, Pentecostal, fire and brimstone Christian preacher, who didn't believe in God. And he would still go and give these talks and, you know, do the full fire and brimstone tent revival kind of thing, even though he himself didn't believe in God. And what he was doing, he was telling the followers what they wanted to hear. So it's the followers that are actually shaping the leadership. So this is a much newer and more recent area of research into leadership. So there are the leaders who are taking lead of a business, of a community, and there are the people within that community, and the influence is now, we know, two-way influence. Some of the research into this was done on research into cheating and how and why people cheat. And there are various mechanisms that the researchers use to encourage people to cheat. Basically, they had a list of questions, 10 questions, what is the average score? Most people get 6.5 out of 10. So they introduced different ways to try and make people cheat. So one of the ways was, they said, well, for every answer you get correct, we give you $1. Do you think more people cheated or less people cheated when they gave their results? More people? Cheating went down. Because nobody wants to say, I cheated for a lousy dollar. Right? So cheating actually went down. They said, and then they said, okay, instead of submitting your paper with how many questions you got right, you count how many questions you got right, you screw your paper up into a ball and throw it in the bin, and then you come and report if you cheated or not. Cheating went up because they know they've got rid of the evidence. Interesting. A lot of areas of research into this. One of the more amusing ones was they tested men and women about how much they cheated on their scores. Do you think men cheated more or women cheated more? It was fairly even, but the interesting thing was, because they really want to make people cheat, the interesting thing was, the cheating was about even, but when they told the women that the men scored an average of 9 out of 10, the women's cheating went right up. When they told the men that the women had a higher average score, the men tended to not be bothered and not cheat. So that was interesting. One of the, another area which was very interesting in this was, when you go and report your score and you get your dollar for every correct answer, people's cheating went down. But if you got a ticket for every correct answer, and then you took that ticket and you went and redeemed it for $1 on the door, cheating went up. Why? Because you're one step removed from that dollar. You cheated to get a ticket. Your ticket got you the money. And that's very interesting because a lot of white-collar cheating goes on in this way. A lot of people, you know, white-collar people would not put their hand in a jar and steal money, but they would cheat on taxes. They would cheat on things like that. The thing I want to wrap up with that I think is important and germane to our discussion is when the people were encouraged to cheat, and the situation was manipulated so that they would cheat. If before the test, the people were asked, what are the Ten Commandments? Not should you follow them, not are you Christian. What are the Ten Commandments? That's all. On every single kind of test that they did, the cheating went down. So, to wrap up, the reason for this is when you talk about it, it changes behavior. And people tend to wait. As leaders, you want to wait. Well, I'm not leader of very much. That's my time up. As a leader, you know, I don't lead very much. I'm not very influential. So you wait. Well, when I'm the Prime Minister of Thailand, you know, obviously you have to be a soldier these days for that, but if I'm the Prime Minister of Thailand, then I will stop cheating. The point is that right from the beginning, it's not leaders affecting followers. It's just as much followers affecting leaders. And the biggest way to bring about change is just to talk about it. So that's what our job as monks is. We are not necessarily the most ethical organization, especially if you read the Bangkok Post. But our job is to talk about it, and talking about it from leaders and the followers is what brings about change. Okay, that would be good.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. I thought we were going to hear about leadership theory, and it sounded more like cheating theory there for a while, but very, very fascinating insights there. So we've heard from Machan Orapin about how sexy business ethics can be seen, and a couple of good, interesting points about what makes up business ethics. Colin mentioned the dictionary of ethics that you'll have if you go to work for the New York Times, and also I think gave us some very nuanced considerations that perhaps we hadn't thought of affecting journalists. Kunmichai talked about the ethics being perhaps cultural consideration, and then went on to introduce us to the oath, which is something that you'll all be given the opportunity to take. And then finally, of course, Prapandit told us that even dogs can be considered part of the ethical sphere because they reflect their owners or their own leaders' particular activities and choices in life. So we've had quite a range of insights here, and I'd be interested to see if anybody has any particular questions. You can put your name tag up so I can see it and we can call.
Can I ask a question? Is that permitted?
Absolutely. You can fire away.
I wanted to ask Colin because he said that because of the internet, ethical standards have gone down. And I might qualify that. Do you mean journalistic standards have gone down? Might it not be the case that good journalism has improved during the internet, but there is more access to poor journalism? And also, hasn't the internet allowed people to bypass a lot of the media corporations so that we can see things like people like Nike behaving unethically because the internet has made that information more readily available?
You're right. I think, actually, to tell you the truth, I think there's, I must admit, I probably watch Facebook far too much. But for me, it's now become the main news source. It's a compilation for me, anyway. I don't have anybody on there showing me what they've just had for dinner or what they're about to wear to go out. For me, it's a compilation of some great magazines and newspapers from around the world. But in amongst those, there are an increasing number of fake stories. And there are websites now set up, there's one called Spokes or something, that actually is focusing on fake stories. And it's a very well visited website because there's such a demand to know how many of these stories we've got on the internet now are actually fake.
Snopes.com.
Yeah, but it's very popular because you can't sometimes tell whether something's true or not. But actually, at the same time, you've got websites turning up on Facebook that are there. They are there to promote a certain cause. I probably shouldn't actually mention which ones bother me so much, but there are certain websites that are either very pro something or very anti something, and you know they're set up. They're set up to make you think, oh, that's a genuine story. But in fact, it's set up to tell you something which is not true. I think that we're going to go back. The circle will turn. And I think that people will eventually just go back to reliable news sources that we used to read, as in the Daily Telegraph in England, New York Times, the Washington Post. I think that people will go back to those and say, at least I can rely on that, because I can't rely on a lot of other stuff that's out there now. Yeah. But it's an interesting thought.
Very much so, very much so. We don't have to stand. Shout it out. Vlad, you got a question, I know, you always do.
Basically, do you, just as an open question, do you think it's, in terms of ethics, do you think it's more a responsibility of the country to give punitive measures or to instill through education ethical ideas to individuals? Or do you think it's more about the individual to practice? It's about the individual to practice ethics, because in a sense, like, it's kind of talking about how some companies, they might have these O's, they might have like all those measures to make audits and things like that. But sometimes it's because there's not much punitive measures, they'll do it anyway, because anyway the cost don't go over the benefits.
Anybody want to take that one?
Well, you can legislate, but no one will practice or believe it. You know, I think personally, I think all this thing is a measure to remind you, more to remind you than to make you, because I think, you know, government cannot change you. They can inform you. They can educate. Yeah, I don't think educate is possible, because when you educate someone, that person can absorb and practice it. But you know, you see all this poster propaganda that, oh, don't corrupt, blah blah blah, all this 40-50 years, but people still cheat, you know, and corrupt. The government civil servants still do, because they don't believe it, and that's pretty sad, but it is. How to make people behave more morally, ethically? Perhaps I have to look to my left side, and hopefully that something that close to your mind, close to your heart, could relate that good deeds, you know, for you to practice. Something your family. Value your family can teach you, your parents can, you know, being a leader in your life, show you the way, set example, good example, your colleagues, your workplace, your boss, things like that. I think those are more effective and could influence you better than books, manual, or the law. That's how I see it.
It's basically that ethics is more community-based, or basically based
community,
on
socially, rather than how you say it, it's mandatory or something. You write in the paper. Yes.
Okay, Ajahn Norepin had something she wanted to say.
Yes, I think the issues of ethical issues and, or you know, ethical behaviors, or the, you know, standard now, it become very important. In the past, you know, if you look into the Thailand 100 years ago, people who got caught of corrupt or unethical conduct, they had been killed seven generations. It means that, you know, three up, three downs. You know, wipe off the whole family. That was the very, very tough punishment in the past, okay? But, you know, since the society changed, you know, the punishment had been relaxed because of the humanity and stuff like that. You know, you cannot kill many people. But, you know, now it become very important because, you know, because of the ignorance of the societies. They had, you know, a lot of corrupt or the unethical behavior have damaged society, and it also damaged, you know, it created a lot of problem to many people. You know, if you look at the Enron because of the unethical business practice, more than 25,000 people lost their job. You know, because of the fall of the Enron, the company, you know. And also a lot of people committing suicide because they lost a lot of money invest in that stock market, you know, for that company, okay? So that is the damage. That's why people, you know, nowadays people will pay more attention on, you know, how to make people doing good thing. And I believe that, you know, doing good thing or make, you know, people to think about the ethical behavior, or you know, to practice in an ethical way is very it can be done. You know, it's very important, especially, you know, it start from family. If the family have the ethical value or more, you know, they can form, you know, the implant that value in their children. The second part is school. Okay, if we can change in the school and we make it strictly in school, you know, the children will absorb that. But that, you know, environment can ruin it, you know, the media and, you know, a lot of things. But the thing is, if you are working later on in your own company or the business, I have experience of try to make people doing good in organization. Okay, people always cheating a little bit here and there. Okay, when I was at TDI, a lot of people, you know, didn't pay much attention. They're making C-lock from their own personal use. But, you know, we came up with a process to make people to be honest. Okay, people can sign up and we charge about 50 stang per page, stuff like that, which is cheap, very cheap, you know, compared to they have to go out to do the photocopies. Or, you know, the telephone in before the mobile, the time of the mobile phone. Okay, and that thing, it become the role of the leader in organization. Even the senior officer, you know, for example, like Dr. Ammar, when he do first photocopy for himself personally, he sign up 2-page personal photocopies. Okay, so that set example. Okay, that's why I say leader is very important to, you know, to form up ethical or unethical organization. I was amazed by his comment that, you know, doing corrupt is okay, depend on the situation, but not okay now. Because we have a lot of good example that people go to jail. You know, if you can remember the Green case, Dutama, the bribery scan, case a few years ago, that, you know, the Donald Green and Patricia Green, went to jail. And the one of the tourist leader of the tourists, now she escaped, you know, and then she also ruined her daughter's life too, because she asked her daughter to open up the account and then deposit the money to that account. So it's not, you know, no secret now in the world. And a lot of company now try to do business, you know, straight business, not corrupt.
Sure. Well, we're trying to encourage that, of course, that thinking amongst our students. And I know there's got to be people out there dying to ask questions. Oh, yeah, I'll watch the hands go up. Lady in the rear, please. Yes.
I have a question for Colin Hastings. I was wondering, do you find, like, tabloids to be unethical, or are they too silly to be taken seriously? Like, Heat magazine, would you consider that to be unethical, or is that just because you know it's a joke, so you wouldn't actually believe anything that's in the magazine?
I can't confess at this moment that I've seen or read Heat, but I have. Something similar to Heat magazine, like, I don't know, FHM?
Yeah, sure.
Something like that. Well, they're silly, they're just, you know, they're enjoyable. They're not unethical, really. I mean, they're a bit slightly immoral, I suppose, but I suppose morality and ethical behavior, not quite the same. So no, I don't think they're unethical. Not really, no. I mean, what are they doing? They do promote certain aspects of life which many people say are undesirable. So in that sense, perhaps they are unethical. That's a tough one. Good question. I'm gonna leave it open, I think, on that one.
Yeah, he could give you a little bit more on that one-on-one afterwards, I think. He has a lot more experience than he wants to share here with the group. Okay, front row, please. Yeah.
Just a question for all the speakers. You know, going into you know, the career and new organizations, how do you all screen candidates and test their ethical standards or ethical values prior to entering the company? What kind of questions do you ask, and how do you measure their performance? I know that they might be perfect candidates for the job. You know, they're on point and everything, but underlying ethical values, how do you test and how do you screen them?
I want to go first on that one.
Go for
it. We don't have any screening process at all, and we let absolutely anybody in.
And you make them good later, right?
Not only that, but you know, in Thailand, if a family has like 3 or 4 sons and it's too many for them, they'll dump one in the temple to get merit. But they'll use the slightly dim-witted one and they'll stick him in the temple. Or if he gets into gangs or if he gets into drugs or something, stick him in the temple. Unfortunately, it's true, but sometimes if a son is gay, they will stick him into the temple, thinking that we'll straighten him out. So, and then people complain that the quality of monks in Thailand is no good. And like, well, that's what you're giving us.
Any other thoughts? Yes.
Well, actually, the guy 2 rooms down from me, he entered the monkhood because his mother had passed away and he got angry. He was a motorcycle taxi driver, and he got angry about his mother dying, and he shot somebody in the knee, and he was avoiding the police, so he went and hid out in the temple. And he's been a monk now 50 years, and he's actually a really good person. I mean, the system is wrong, and yet sometimes it works. No, I don't think so. No, nothing to do with it. Yes. Somebody who annoyed him at the time. So, you know, it's like the House of Lords in England. It's a ridiculous system, but it kind of works.
Can we check up?
Yeah, just a little bit follow up on that. I have my personal view that we kind of like lose up on the standard and the quality of goodies that we want. You know, I believe that when you want to ordain as a monk, there's a certain set of criteria that you have to meet. And I think over the year, because the kind of Thai norm, Thai culture, we are very jidi, you know, very good-hearted people. So okay, never mind, sabai, you know. So we allow good people, not so good people, to enter the monkhood. Perhaps we could change them to clean them up, but you know, we overlook the process. Yeah, we just dress them up as a monk, but we forget to clean their mind. So maybe we have that problem, and perhaps we think we might need some change in that process. But back to the company, how we screen. I think from my personal experience that, you know, because when you're the small company, you have time to interview, you have time to feel or sense the individual way of thinking, you know, the attitude, the mindset when you interview, you know, one-on-one. And that helps you screen. If you, for example, the interviewer have a good set of moral behavior and you need to recruit. This is like old days, mom and pop shop company. But when you're starting to have big company, you have HR department, you hire someone to be your HR manager, and you let those people to interview. And the set up standard, or whether the ethical, moral, goodies, they're different. So you rely on those people. And you use outsourced company, you know, HR company consultant, a set of books, follow this guideline. Whether or not you believe it wholeheartedly, whether or not you agree, but you pay for this set of questionnaire, so follow and score them. If you get good score, you pass, and on and on and on. So it's quite different that or difficult to say that you have a very good process in doing that. Except if you are, I still believe in kind of one-on-one interview. So you hire someone in a very senior or a very important roles, and you need to trust them. You need to talk to them. You need to feel them. But if an okay so-so position, you know, just like a daily officer, then you might have to rely and take risks from other people belief and value the interview for you. So It's really, I think the many of the even bigger company in Thailand, they also practice a similar way. And you know, you heard that CP, they also have extra step, you know, to ensure fortune teller to screen, birthday, things like that, and look at the face and computerize them now. If you fit the profile, pop, 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 you pass the first screen. But then if you really work in a very good position, then personal interview will become involved. That's kind of like, I don't know if I answered the question, but that's kind of the process.
It's interesting. I thought Ajahn Orapin's comment about firing people, you know, would you say firing or killing? I'm not sure what it was, you know, that's a, when people see that as an example, that's pretty scary.
Because I look around the room, you are young, perhaps some of you are going to look for a job. Different companies have different process to screen people. It depends on what their process to use. Okay, but the thing is, the very important thing is, if you want to be success in the real world in the future, try to change now, stick with ethical behavior, and build within yourself, you know, the, you know, what we call integrity or honesty and stuff like that. Okay, I have examples. A lot of time, when they interview, the first face-to-face interview, sometimes a lot of people are so smart, they can fake. You won't get the real thing, you know, whether the person are good or bad. Okay, several companies had what we call the try period. Okay. The try period, if you're not so good, you will not pass. People will catch up. In my life, I met one person, a man. He came and worked with organization, and unfortunately, the president asked me to mentor him. It was his bad luck, you know. He was a big liar. Young PhD. He said he got PhD from United States. Okay, in finished law school. Okay, we need the legal person to work in the team, so we hire him. But he during his period, I talked to him. The third time I caught that he lied. He's a big lie. His story will not sync together. See, if you're not telling the truth, your brain is going to go to a very complexity, because you have to remember what have you said to this person 3 days ago, what have you said to another person 2 days ago. Okay, I talked to him at lunchtime 3 times. I found out this guy is very funny. His profile was too good to be true. He told me that he was 29, okay? 29 is okay to get PhD, okay. And then I was a doubt that whether how come he got, his profile is not matched together. So I asked I asked to see his CV, because you know we have to apply. When I was working as a research director at TDRI, Thailand Development Research Institute. So I found out that he was not 29. If he was not 29, it's impossible to get PhD, right? From his profile, he has a very, very funny CV. Okay, and I said, oh, look at his CV. I don't think he was a real one. Actually, he never graduated even the bachelor degree. He's a big lie. And you know what is man now? He was killed few months after he left TDI. I told the president, we cannot pass him through the try period. So we just terminate his contact. And then because he was not, he was a big lie, so he lied to many people. And actually, he was killed. He even lied to his parents. His father never knew that he never finished education. But he started up with, he was, what do you call, he was nominated as the outstanding youth of the country. He went to study in England, and then he moved to the U.S. You know, from England and U.S., he never got any degree. But he came back, you know, he was, you know, he has the name card of, you know, the Institute of Director. He said he's a member of the Institute of Director in England. Oh, wow, his profile was so good. So I tell you that, you know, if you want to be success in the future and you want to be good, be the real ethical person, because it will show no matter where you are. Okay, I had a very good experience of being honest, because my father always said, honesty is the best policy. That's how I got my PhD, easily, happily, because of my honesty. I tell you the story later on next time.
I was going to ask if you were 25 when you got your PhD. Okay, all right. Thank you very much. There was another question on the front row. Yes.
So for Mr. Colin, actually, so you mentioned that journalism and journalists are, I guess, very high risk to corruption or bribery or anything like that. And I was wondering, what do you do for your company or your magazine to prevent any corruption or any unethical, you know, publishing?
Well, we are a small company, so I don't have too many problems with what is written. I'm pretty in touch with whatever goes through the magazine. Other things can happen. I mean, my staff can, you know, they can lie about where they've been. In fact, I'm just on a case at the moment. They can lie about what they, you know, what they said they've been doing, or what they're going, or what they're claiming. And in which case, I do the normal thing: send a letter. If it's really serious, I send a letter of warning, a warning letter saying that if anything else happens like this again, you're out. Which I think is the legal way of doing it. But in terms of, you know, stories, there are stories in my magazine which some of my advertisers, they like to, instead of having a you know, a proper ad, they like to take a page in the magazine which is about is written with, you know, photographs. So I get someone to write a story about that restaurant, for example, and the restaurant pays for it, and it's very positive. We can't make it negative, of course, because it's being paid for. So I have to say that sometimes even my ethical standards, which I readily admit, actually, are probably not as high as I should be. But you know, what you look out for in newspapers overseas and here in Thailand, you can actually spot some of the stories that have been placed. You can tell that someone's actually, by just looking at the story, the nature of the story, if it's too favorable, too positive, and it's just, for example, a business story, if you see that there's only, you know, like one person being quoted, and that's the MD, you're gonna think, well, that's like a PR release, you know, public relations release, or that's been done by a lobbyist, and they've managed to persuade a journalist to put that in with some you know, reward under the table. After a while, you can, as a journalist, you can recognize what is legitimate and what is not after a while. But interesting, all interesting questions, by the way.
Yeah, when you do that, Colin, do you mark them as advertorials on the, yeah, I would think so. Okay, well, I would see nothing wrong with that.
I got a question for Pa Bandit. You were saying about the changing ethical way by talking, but I believe that talking about ethic is not easy in the workplace, right, in the business. So is it other ways that we can, techniques that we can talk about this, more open in the workplace?
Yeah, what can I say? I mean, if you People like to talk about what's exciting, right? The new Oculus Rift I was just talking about on the way here with my friend. You know, Oculus Rift, the virtual reality goggles, these are exciting. There's a lot of things you can do with them, ethical and non-ethical. Is morality and ethics, not quite the same thing, but is that an exciting topic to talk about? Well, that's what we have to do to change society. The other question is, does punishment work better or does encouragement work better? And most of our research into pretty much everything shows that punishment of bad behavior is not as effective as encouragement of good behavior. If you've raised children, you should know this. There is one exception in psychology, but basically every time. I'll give an example, compare American prisons to prisons in Norway. In America, you have 7.5 million people in prison, parole or jail, which are not quite the same thing. That makes it round about 1 in 60 people. If you count blacks between 18 and 30, it's down to about 1 in 4. You go to Norway, it's 1 person in 1,400 is in prison. There is a massive difference. And one of those differences is American prisons, in most of America, not all of it, are there to punish. And Norwegian prisons are there to rehabilitate. So the question is of encouraging the right behavior may not seem as effective as punishing the wrong behavior, but long term, that's what we have to do.
Yes.
About the Facebookers at the back here.
I was just going to go after that row. I agree.
So I apologize for the, maybe there might be some hostility the way I framed the question, but not at all, actually. I just hope you understand that. Because I'm going to you. Because so do you consider the fact, as Dr. Orapan said earlier, corporations are members of society. They are inherently responsible for their effects on society, to preserve the dignity, etc. All of these values of society. Thereby, I would consider temples, churches, mosques, etc., also to be members of society. And for example, in the United States, churches are kind of, you know where I'm going with this already, don't you? They don't pay taxes. They waive taxes. So a lot of people might argue that that's unethical. Whereas here, monks are kind of, they waive the bus fee. So I might consider that as well unethical. But it's a structural problem. It's a system itself. I'm not saying that you yourself are participating to it. But where do you stand on that? Do you believe it's an unethical practice? Churches should pay their taxes? Monks should pay for the bus fee? Or should the system continue as it is?
I think you're confusing ethics with fairness. You're saying, you know, if I don't pay on the bus, that might be unfair because you have to pay, but I can point to a lot of things where you get advantages over me, which is also unfair. I don't think we live in a world that it is possible to be fair. As looking at this research, I'm a psychologist, he mentioned fairy tales. Maybe ethics is about fairy tales, but psychology is my main kind of field other than Buddhism. And there are one of the things that we study is influence, and the things that influence people are so varied. For example, you are more likely to succeed as a politician if you're good looking. Simply being born with those features gives you an unfair advantage. male and female. We have different things. In some cases, males get an advantage. In some cases, females get an advantage. Young and old, I have an advantage because I have a British passport, right? And we talk about Brexit and we say, oh, I don't want these foreigners in my country. It's not my country. I don't own it. I just happen to have that British passport and I get this huge set of advantages. I can go back to England and have a heart operation, whereas somebody here can't. So I don't believe we live in a fair world. I don't think we can make the world fair at all. But that's not the case of being ethical. I think ethics, doing the right thing, is something that we can aspire to, at least. And talking about that aspiration is encouraging it to start to happen.
Interesting thought. Yes, we'll go here and then here. Yes.
So I have a question for Mr. Colin. I want to know, in terms of the journalism industry or your company, do you have any like control mechanism to your staff, whether they are actually buying the stories unethically, or do you have any preventive measures if it has been exposed that you have received the stories unethical ways?
As I mentioned earlier, my company is rather small, so I'm pretty much in charge. I pretty much know what stories are coming in. On a bigger newspaper, which I have worked, of course, bigger newspapers, it's hard always to have that same kind of control. But department heads will surely know that stories are being planted, or they should, or that if they don't, they are either in the wrong job, or they're complicit or involved in that, possible corruption. In my case, I don't see it. I can't think of a single, over 16 years of doing the magazine, I can't think of a single time when I've been given a story which I felt uncomfortable with that I thought was being planted. There's reasons for the stories that go into my magazine for being there that I'm aware of. I'm very aware of what goes in the magazine, and I know I can cover every base, to be honest with you. As I said, it's not so easy if you've got a newspaper with 80 journalists churning out stories on a daily basis. You can't possibly know. But it's not difficult to tell either. Not difficult to tell. Did you say what actions you take? I don't know, but if you did, as I said, you obviously have to warn people that they can't use your publication in this way, and issue those letters warning them of any repeat, and that's them on the bus, goodbye. But interesting.
I think because you've got publisher down there, they think you've got a whole empire of magazines out there. They don't realize a real flagship is really it, right? Okay. All right, so yes, thank you.
Just want to ask Mr. Vichai, through the point that he mentioned, corruption sometimes is attack. So can you point out a bit about your experience related with this point?
Yeah. Well, pardon me if I said it wrong. I didn't say it. Well, I didn't want to say that corruption is ethic. But in one standard of set of corruption in one place might be okay in another place, by giving favors or, well, look at this, from Eastern world and Western world, some of the practice where the Western world may seem as it's a part of the corruption, why in the Eastern world seems like, okay, this is, kind of socially, normally practiced and acceptable. Deep down, maybe it's gray area, but for example, we see a lot of this donation or campaign for fundraising, blah, 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 a lot in this part of the world, especially Thailand. Not especially, but you see commonly in Thailand that we have fundraising for so many things. But in the Western world, when some country standard say that if you donate or you're giving that money to this fundraising and you expect or you know that this will return some favor mentally, not even have to come back with something tangible. Mentally, the people you give money to feel favorable to you later. It's corruption. But Thai, you say, okay, this is networking, this is connection, this is it's okay because this might be something can help me in the future. This is something you haven't corrupted yet. But maybe this can be seen as your way, you buy your way to the corruption later. So it's really depends, like Sasin said. It really depends on how you look at it. But my thing, I tend to kind of lean to the Western kind of side that, okay, if you helping and by expecting some favor to in return, then you're one step into that gray area already.
Colin, you had something?
Yeah, I was just going to say that what has become quite clear in the last decade, maybe two decades, is the power and the influence of the lobby system in Britain and the United States, that politicians are being lobbied by professional lobbyists, and in return for contributions to their, you know, their party or their political stance, they will get back in return some kind of advantages or favors. It's become a major problem, and you know, it's, for me, it's a little bit irritating when I hear Western politicians talking about corruption in government in other countries, when actually corruption in Western democracies is actually these days pretty rampant, especially in, you know, in government level. And yes, it's in many ways no different from here, if probably on a great grander scale in the West, frankly speaking.
Prapandit, did I see you? Prat, were you reaching for the mic? You were going to say no, okay.
No, but we do have time to follow with Alex. It's kind of with all the Transparency International information you get. Do you think it's not that Thailand did not do a job, but other countries got better at identifying corrupt activities in their countries?
Well, okay. Well, we're going to close it down at this point. But Achan Orapin has one more thing to say.
The TI index, you know, corruption index. In fact, you know, it's pretty biased. If you look into how they got that, you know, index, you know, they went out and interviewed several people. What is called perspective index? It means that how they think, how they view. Okay, if they're talking about, you know, and then they come to talk to several business people, you know, how they look at Thailand, and then we didn't even know who they are, okay? And they look at several indicators that what have we done. In fact, you know, in Thailand, we have done a lot, you know, in terms of try to curb corruption, you know, try to really tackle the problems. I've been working in this area more than 30 years, you know, and I think the metro now is getting better, and then we have a lot of mechanism to get after. If you can see that, you know, there's a lot of people now end up, there's no place to stay in Thailand, or end up, you know, outside, they have to run away from Thailand, or a lot of them in jail now. Okay, so, you know, you are future. Businessman, or you are working, you are the future of the workforce. You know, what I want to emphasize is, you know, if you want the next generation, you know, corruption and unethical behavior may not be. I don't think they will be acceptable in the next generations in doing business and stuff like that. So you need to really be what you call the real ethical person, you know, to do the job in the futures.
Absolutely, sure.
You know, ethical behavior back in the West, ethical behavior here in Thailand. I mean, a lot of talk about the son of the Red Bull heir getting away with somehow getting away with not facing up to his alleged crimes. And I think, well, you know, people use that as an example, say that's people in high places able to push that aside. I'm not saying it's what they're doing is right, obviously not, but in the West there's just been recently government papers that should have been released about a former prime minister in Britain, a former prime minister's son, about his arms deals with the Middle East. He was caught up in a huge corruption situation on an arms deal in the Middle East, but he has been his activities have been covered up deliberately by someone in government. He'll never be held responsible for those actions. Here in Thailand, something else is happening at that level. So what I'm trying to say is that basically, even at high levels, corruption or covering up unethical behavior happens in the West as well as here.
Hey, well, thank you very, very much. And we'll ask for a round of applause for our panel here one last time. And I think Achan, Nick, you have a few words to say. Achan Sarol, Kap.
So we have a